All right, guys, we are delighted to have a very special keynote speaker to kick us off tonight. I'd like you to imagine with me, you're standing at the foot of Mount Rushmore. How many have ever been there, seen it? You're standing there with an atheist, and as you look at it, you would conclude, looking at Mount Rushmore, obviously this was designed and created. The atheists would look at that and say, no. After billions of years of natural erosion, wind and rain, that is how we have this uncanny resemblance of four U.S. presidents. Now, that's just the side of a hill. If I were to extrapolate that logic to the complexity of the earth and the majesty of the universe, you can understand why Frank Turek would say, I don't have enough faith to be an atheist. He's a dynamic speaker and award-winning author, co-author of four books. The aforementioned, I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist, Stealing from God, Why Atheists Need God to Make Their Case, Correct, Not Politically Correct, and his fourth book, Legislating Morality, which he'll be talking a lot about more, tomorrow morning. Frank also writes a column for townhall.com. As the president of crossexamined.org, he impacts young and old alike at colleges, high schools, and churches with hard yet entertaining evidence for Christianity. He also hosts an hour-long TV program each week called I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist. And his radio program called Cross Examined with Frank Turek airs on 143 stations across America. We're delighted to have him as our featured speaker tonight. So, ladies and gentlemen, would you join me in welcoming to the stage Frank Turek?
Thanks, Bill.
Go again, Frank.
Thanks, Bill.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Evening.
As Gil said, my name is Frank Turek. Before I get started, let me ask you this. How many of you have heard me before, or this is your first time? How many of you are here this evening? All right, how many don't respond to surveys? One, two. Pastor Jack, 3 out of 10 don't respond to surveys. I got an email not long ago from a United States Marine. So I knew this meant, yes, the Marine Corps, ladies and gentlemen. I was in the Navy. Hoorah, that's right. I was in the Navy, which stands for Never Again Volunteer Yourself. But this man was a Marine, which is also part of the Navy. But he wasn't writing me as a tough guy. He was actually writing me as a distraught father. He said, my daughter was the top Christian student in her high school class. She won several scholarships from Christian organizations to go to any college she wanted to. She even helped lead the youth group at church. And we sent her off to the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill to win the campus for Christ. And it needs to be won for Christ. And he said, about 4 weeks into her first semester, I got a phone call from her. Her words devastated me. She said, Dad, I don't believe in God anymore. Don't believe in God anymore, what? He said, I got in my car, I drove 4 hours to sit down with her that weekend, and I got nowhere with her. What do you mean you don't believe in God anymore? What happened? She said, well, you know, I've got this atheist who teaches the New Testament class. Yeah, the atheists teach the classes there. And we don't even know who wrote the Gospels according to this guy, and the Bible has errors in it, so Dad, I'm an atheist now. Now, question, is this young woman typical or atypical of young Christian students who go off to college? Yeah, typical. What do you think the percentage is who walk away from the church once they get to college? Yeah, it depends on the survey, but Barna and Lifeway did a little research and said about 75% walk away. About half or so come back by the time they're age 30, but the other half never do. Now, there's a number of reasons for this. One of the reasons is intellectually, they don't know why Christianity is true because we've never told them why it's true. We've never really given them any evidence. We just say, go out and believe. Well, do you think the atheistic college professors just say, oh, just believe what I say. Let me not give you any evidence. No, the atheistic college professors try and give evidence. And by the way, atheists, or I should say college professors, are 5 times more likely to be atheists than the general public. And 53% of college professors view evangelical students unfavorably. And guess what? I don't blame them. Why? Because most evangelical students, when they get to college, they can't give a reason, an objective reason, why Christianity is true. So I understand why these professors are unimpressed with evangelical students. It shouldn't be that way. The greatest commandment of all is love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind. Christians don't get brownie points for being stupid. We're supposed to know what we believe and why we believe it. And you know what? It's really not all that hard to show that Christianity is true. You only need to answer four questions in the affirmative. In other words, if you ask these four questions and get evidence to answer these questions yes, you can show beyond any reasonable doubt that Christianity is true. Not beyond all doubt, but beyond a reasonable doubt. What are the four questions? Here are the four questions. Some pretty grooving music, isn't it? Yeah. That is actually from our TV show. As Gil said, it's on every Wednesday nights. Here on the West Coast, it would be 6 p.m. and 10 p.m. on Wednesday nights. DirecTV channel 378. How many people here have DirecTV? Can I show your hands, please? DirecTV. That's it? What, like eight of us? Come on. Friends don't let friends watch cable. If you want to get out and have enough faith to be an atheist, you got to get DirecTV. Actually, that's not true, because if you go to this website, that's our website right there, crossexamine.org, at those times, you can watch it streaming live. It's also on Roku. Have you guys heard of Roku? It's on Roku as well, and you can also get DVDs off our website. We're on radio every Saturday morning. The station number always changes, but I don't think it's on in this area, but that's okay. It's podcasted, and it's also on our new app, the Cross Examined app, which you need to download. The app is free, and it has all the podcasts on there, and it also has a quick answer section. So if you're talking to somebody about Christianity, and they say something that you think is wrong, but you're not quite sure how to answer it, get the Cross-Examined app, go to the quick answer section. Chances are, the objection they've brought up is right there on the app, and there's an answer to it, okay? About 66,000 people at last count have downloaded it, so they're finding it helpful, so download it. Did I mention that it was free? Okay, good, it's free. All right. Now, why are these the four questions? Truth, God, miracles, and the New Testament. Well, because if there is no truth, or if it's true for you but not for me, or all truth is relative, then quite obviously this book can't be true. Of course, if there is no truth, then any book written by an atheist can't be true either. Right? We're going to deal with that question first. Second question, does God exist? You can't have a word from God if there's no God. If there's no God, throw the Bible away and every other book that talks about God. But I hope to show you tonight that there really is a theistic God out there. What do I mean by a theistic God? A spaceless, timeless, immaterial, powerful, moral, personal, intelligent, sustaining cause. That being actually exists, and we're going to look at three arguments. Two have scientific evidence behind them. One has philosophical evidence behind it. And while these arguments are taught in the Bible, you don't need the Bible to know them. In fact, we're not even going to reference the Bible on these arguments. We're just going to look at the evidence and draw a conclusion. Then we can get to question three. Are miracles possible? Obviously, the Bible can't be true if miracles are not possible. And a lot of people don't believe in miracles. But I hope to show you tonight that not only are miracles possible, but the greatest miracle in the Bible has already occurred, and we have scientific evidence for it. Then and only then can we get to the key question, is the New Testament true? The New Testament doesn't have a prayer if there's no truth, no God, or no miracles. But if truth exists, God exists, and miracles are possible, then we can see if we have an accurate, historically reliable account of other miracles occurring in the first century to a man named Jesus and his apostles, as recorded in the 27 handwritten Greek manuscripts we put under one binding we now call the New Testament. Do the documents here actually tell us the truth, or were they written much later by religious zealots who embellished it and made it up? We're going to see here, we probably won't actually get all the way there tonight because I'm going to be speaking on this on Sunday morning, second service, but we're going to see that the New Testament documents are actually telling the truth. Now, some of you are going, what about the Old Testament? Believe the Old Testament's true? Well, look, if the New Testament's reliable, you get the Old Testament thrown in. Why? Who's in the New Testament that can authenticate the Old Testament? Jesus, right? If Jesus really is God, as the New Testament documents claim he is, now that's a big if, but if he really is God, whatever God teaches is true. Jesus taught the entire Old Testament as the Word of God, so if the New Testament's reliable, you get the Old Testament thrown in. Now, there's other ways of arguing, but, and the book goes into a lot more detail. I don't have enough faith to be an atheist, goes into 12 points. These are the main four, however, and if you want to go deeper, you can, because there's actually no way I can cover all these points here tonight. Actually, I probably could cover them because I'm originally from New Jersey, okay? I speak at 150 words a minute with gusts to 350, okay? So if you can't keep up, the book is available on the book table, as well as a 12-part DVD set that is broken up into lessons, 20 to 40-minute lessons. There's a workbook that goes with it if you want it. It's all this presentation plus the PowerPoint, and then there's a new book called Stealing from God, Why Atheists Need God to Make Their Case out there as well. And by the way, all the proceeds from the sale of the books and the DVDs will go to feed needy children. Mine. Okay? Just so you know, I got three sons, so I need some help. Actually, they're a little bit older now. In fact, as I said, I was in the Navy. My oldest two sons were interested in the military, and they said, "Dad, we're interested in the military." I was about to go to college, you know. What military branch should we go in? I said, "Well, look, if you want to fight, go Navy. Wherever there's a problem, we pull our airport up and we take care of it, okay? But if you want a nice life, go Air Force." So they went Air Force. The oldest one's an intelligence officer. The second one is a KC-10 pilot. And the third one's not in the military, but he is out of the house now. We live in Charlotte, North Carolina now, my wife and I do. He's now actually in Birmingham, Alabama, so my wife and I are now empty nesters. Yeah, it took us a while to get used to that. About 10 minutes. Yeah, that's how long it took to change the locks. Do we have any empty nesters in here? You notice how clean the house stays when they're gone? We love our kids, but they're messy. Now, if you don't want to buy any of this stuff, that's fine, because we're going to email you a PDF portion of this particular PowerPoint presentation and some other stuff. If you type into your browser, crossexamine.org/summit. Now, why Summit? Because I teach at Summit. In fact, the president of Summit is here. You're going to hear from him tomorrow. His name is Jeff Myers, and you don't want to miss that presentation. Summit is a Christian worldview camp for high school and college kids, and it's a phenomenal place. And the presentation I'm giving you tonight is the same presentation I give them, and it's the same presentation I give on college campuses, okay? If you want that material, just type that into your browser, email us, and we're going to email it to you, okay? And by the way, if I time this just right, we'll have absolutely no time for questions. Actually, we will have time for questions. I don't know if Gil said we're going to do a little bit of Q&A at the end of this. He didn't say that? Well, actually, if he did, he was wrong, because we're not going to do Q&A. We're going to do all Q, no A. All right? Takes all the pressure off me, and everybody gets to ask a question. All right. Are you guys ready to go? All right. Let's start right here on, does truth exist? Does truth exist? Now, for those of you who go to Calvary Chapel, Chino Hills, you know it exists because you've got Pastor Jack, right? Now, while he is a little bit shy, I think most of the time he tells you the truth, doesn't he? All right. But whenever you start talking about truth, you always have to start with Jack Nicholson. Right? Because Tom Cruise had him on the witness stand, and he said to him, "Colonel, I want the truth." And Nicholson said, "That was pretty weak. Let's try that again. Colonel, I want the truth." Well, there's a lot of people out there that can't handle the truth. They're saying, "You got your truth, I got my truth, there is no truth, all truth is relative." If you don't learn anything else from what we talk about here the rest of the night, if you get this one idea down, it's going to be worth your time. In fact, I submit to you, I started seminary in 1993, and I didn't even know this then, and this is the most valuable thinking skill I've ever learned, what we're about to talk about right now. In fact, half of what you need to know and to defend the Christian faith is in this little thinking skill we're about to go through. Are you ready? If someone were to ever say to you, there is no truth, you should ask that person a question. What should the question be? Is that true? Is it true that there is no truth? Because if it's true that there is no truth, the claim there is no truth can't be true, but it claims to be true. Did I say that right? This is known as a self-defeating statement. It does not meet its own standard. A self-defeating statement is like saying, I can't speak a word in English. Right? I'm saying English to say it. Or my brother is an only child. Or my parents had no kids that lived. Or everything I say is a lie. Some of you will get that tomorrow. Or all generalizations are false. Some of you will never get that one. In fact, my youngest son, he has a favorite self-defeating statement. This will take a minute to get, but this is his favorite one. He says, Hitler wasn't such a bad guy. After all, he killed Hitler. Self-defeating statements are everywhere in our culture. They don't meet their own standard. And if you learn how to turn a claim on itself, you are going to become a fearless Christian apologist. That's somebody not apologizing. That's somebody who gives evidence for what they believe. And one way to give evidence for what you believe is to show that what somebody else says is false. And sometimes it's just asking a question. So if somebody says there is no truth, you say, is that true? Now, we call this process in the book, we call it the Roadrunner tactic. You can get the book to see why, but with this one little tactic, you look like a super genius. All right? How about if somebody says this, there's no such thing as absolute truth. You should ask that person a question. You should apply the claim to itself. What question should you ask him? Yeah, is that an absolute truth claim? Or if you want to be fun, you could say, are you absolutely sure? See, because that is an absolute truth claim. It claims there are no absolute truths, yet it's an absolute truth itself. Once again, you look like a super genius. Actually, my favorite one is this one. It's true for you, but not for me. If somebody says it's true for you, but not for me, what question should you ask them?
Is that true?
Close. This is also self-defeating. It's just a little bit more subtle. If somebody says it's true for you, but not for me, say, is that true for everybody? Is true for you, but not for me, true for everybody? Because if true for you, but not for me, is true for everybody, then true for you, but not for me, can't be true because it's true for everybody. Did I say that right? I know that can give you intellectual constipation if you think about it long enough. But that's because it's a self-defeating statement. It doesn't meet its own standard. It's like saying I can't speak a word in English. Actually, there's a more fun way of dealing with this. If somebody says it's true for you, but not for me, say, sure, go try that with your bank teller. Yeah, go to your bank teller one day and say, look, the economy is down, I need some extra money. Give me $100,000 out of my account. The bank teller looks at your account and says, I'm sorry, sir, you only have $6.14 in your account. Very easy to get the money. You simply say, that's true for you, but not for me. Give me the $100,000. You going to get the money? No, if it's true there was only $6.14 in your account, that's true for all people at all times in all places when referring to your account at that time. It's just true. And by the way, I go to a lot of churches, and I normally ask the people in church, do you believe this book is true? And most people will say yes, and then I'll say, why do you think it's true? Do you know what answer I get more than any other? Because I have faith. Is that a good answer? Does your faith change whether or not this book is true? Does your faith change whether or not God exists or Jesus rose from the dead? No, your faith doesn't say a thing about those things. I mean, do you have to believe something to make it true? Do you have to believe in gravity to stay on the ground? Do people who don't believe in gravity float away? Hey, look, there's another one. Hey, if you believe, you'll come back. No, it's not the way it works. You say, why is the Bible always talking about faith then? Because there's two kinds of faith. This is very important. Two kinds of faith. There's belief that you get evidence that Christianity is true, that God exists, that Jesus rose from the dead. That's what we mean by apologetics. That's getting evidence. But then there's belief in. Belief that is, getting the evidence that it's true. Belief in is after you know it's true, trusting in Christ for your salvation, according to the scriptures. The first is intellectual. The second is not just intellectual, it's also volitional. Even James, the half-brother of Jesus, wrote, "Even the demons believe that God exists, but they tremble." Why do they tremble? They know intellectually better than we do that God exists, but they don't put their trust in Him because they don't want to. So there's a difference between belief that and belief in. In fact, when I first met my wife about 30 years ago, we actually met in San Diego. We got married at the Balboa Naval Chapel down there, which is now a museum. Not because we got married there, but... And when I first met her, I got evidence that she would be a good wife. But all the evidence in the world didn't make her my wife. I had to take a step of trust in her to ask her to be my wife. And in a momentary lapse of judgment, she said yes. See, that's the difference between belief that and belief in. Most of the time when the Bible's talking about faith, it's talking about the second kind, belief in. After you know that, it's true, trust in it. In fact, John even says at the end of the book of John, he says, "These things were done so that you may know that Jesus is the Savior and that by believing in His name, you can have eternal life." That's the whole thing right in one verse, belief that and belief in. How about this? You hear this a lot. There's no truth in anything but science. When you go to college, you're going to hear that. First of all, what's the problem with the claim? Can anyone see the problem? What question would you ask somebody who says this? Yes, you'd say, is that a scientific truth? Can you go in the laboratory and prove that? No, that's a philosophical claim. And what is so often forgotten is you can't do science without philosophy. Science is built on philosophy. In fact, when you get a PhD, what does a PhD stand for? Philosophy. What is it? Piled high deep. Okay. Are there any PhDs in here? We have some friends down here. It's philosophy. You can't read the newspaper without philosophy. In fact, there is a chapter in the new book, Stealing from God, Why Atheists Need God to Make Their Case. And the chapter title is about science. And the title says, science doesn't say anything, scientists do. Science doesn't say anything, scientists do. All data needs to be gathered. All data needs to be interpreted. Science doesn't do that. Science is a method that scientists use. And many times, the philosophical worldview of the scientist will dictate how they gather and interpret the evidence. If they've already ruled out intelligent causes before they looked at the evidence, and they have because they're materialists, then it's no wonder that they always interpret their scientific data as if there is no God. So get that book if you want more on that. The main point here is it's self-defeating. How about this? This is the granddaddy of them all. You ought not judge. Christians, why are you judging? Jesus said, don't judge. Stop judging! Now, first of all, logically, what's the problem with the claim? If somebody says you ought not judge, what should you say to them? Yeah! You might say, isn't that a judgment? Or why are you judging me for judging? Now, did Jesus say, don't judge? Is that all He said? No, what does He say? You see, atheists have a memory verse. It's Matthew 7:1, judge not, but they don't go any further. Judge not, lest you be judged. By the same standard you judge others, you'll be judged by that standard. So before you try and take the speck out of your brother's eye, take the log out of your own eye first, then you'll be better able to help your brother. Now, is Jesus telling us not to judge here? No, He's telling us to take the speck out of our brother's eye. That involves making a judgment. He's simply saying, get that problem out of your life first so you can better help your brother. So this is not a command not to judge. It is a command on how to judge. If you've got that problem in your life, get it out of your life first, and then you can better help your brother. So this is a command. Just don't judge hypocritically. That's what this is saying. Think about it. It would be complete suicide to say don't make judgments. Think about how many judgments you've made today between right and wrong, good and evil, safe choices from dangerous choices. Everybody makes judgments. Atheists make judgments. They judge there's no God. They judge you're wrong. Muslims make judgments. Buddhists make judgments. Christians make judgments. Agnostics even make judgments. There's not enough evidence. That's a judgment. Everybody makes judgments. The only question is, are your judgments true? That's why Jesus said in John 7:24, he said, stop judging by mere appearances and make a right judgment. I will say this, however, Jesus did save a very stern rebuke for people who were judgmental. And who were the judgmental ones in his day? The Pharisees. And who were the Pharisees? What did they do? They were the religious and political leaders of Israel. Remember, the Romans delegated much of the political authority to the Sanhedrin, on whom were the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And the Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection. That's why they were Sadducee. You got to go to seminary for that. Delayed reaction. Jesus went after these people. They were the religious and political leaders. Are you telling me Jesus got involved in politics? Yes! And you know what? I know this is going to sound crazy, but he wasn't so nice doing it. By the way, if you, do you ever hear somebody say, well, that person is such a saint, he's never said a bad word about anyone. If that is the definition of a saint, Jesus was no saint. Just read Matthew chapter 23. Have you ever read Matthew chapter 23? This is Jesus talking to the Sadducees and the Pharisees, the scribes and the Pharisees. And here's what he says in Matthew chapter 23. These are religious and political leaders. He says, woe to you scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You strain out a gnat and swallow a camel. Oh, you look great on the outside, you're whitewashed tombs, but inside you're full of dead men's bones. You go a mile to make a convert, and then once you make them a convert, you make them twice as much a son of hell as you are. How will you avoid being condemned to hell? What? Sweet and gentle Jesus said this? Yes, Jesus was not Barney. Can't we all just get along, boys and girls? He was not Mr. Rogers. Can't you say kindness, boys and girls? I mean, he was kind most of the time, but he certainly didn't go around saying, this sermon brought to you by the letter R. Jesus was tough. And sometimes he was very, very direct. He just told people straight out. And sometimes you need to be direct. Sometimes you need to slap somebody upside that person's head and just say, look, you're messing up. Knock it off. Good method. You must have a teenager. So don't buy into this idea that you can't ever tell the truth directly. Now, Jesus was almost caustic with these people. I don't necessarily recommend that, but the idea that you have to be soft and sweet and just be so winsome and loving, that's not in the Bible, okay? We've totally sissified Jesus. By the way, I've also noticed one other thing about judging. Do you ever notice when you compliment somebody, which, by the way, is a judgment, people don't get upset? Like if I were to say to Pastor Jack, you're just a wonderful pastor. I wish we could clone you and put you in every church out there. So we could just turn this country and this world around for Jesus. Amen. Pastor Jack, you're wonderful. Do you think he would say, are you judging me? Who do you think you are? You think you're worse than me? No, he's not going to say that. You see, I've noticed that people don't have a problem with judgments. They just have a problem with judgments that they don't like. You see, as Augustine said, we love the truth when it enlightens us. We hate the truth when it convicts us. Now, there's a lot of others we can talk about. Like if somebody says all truth is relative, you're going to ask what? Apply the claim to itself. Is that a relative truth? If somebody says you can't know anything, you're going to say, then how do you know that? Right? You got the idea. Continue to apply the claim to itself. We don't have time to go any further, but this roadrunner tactic reminds me of a lie detector test, because if you can learn how to apply a claim to itself, you can be a lie detector, and half of what you need to know, you already know, just by that one tactic. So let's summarize the truth about truth. Contrary beliefs are possible, but contrary truths are not possible. You can believe everything's true, but everything can't be true. You can believe the earth is flat if you want. It's not going to make it flat. And objective truths can't be denied without being affirmed. Suppose someone says there are no objective truths. What question should you ask them? Use the roadrunner tactic, apply the claim to itself. What question would you ask them? Yeah, is that an objective truth? If they say yes, they've just defeated their statement. If they say no, it's just in me, the subject. It has no external objective referent. In other words, it's just my opinion. Then why should I believe it? You see, you can't get away from objective truth. It's out there. Actually, there is one way to get away from it, at least temporarily. You know how you get away from truth? You suppress it to go your own way. And we all do this, but Paul talks about it in detail in Romans chapter 1. We suppress the truth and unrighteousness to go our own way. We know what the truth is. We know there's a God. We know there's a creator God. We know there's a moral God. It's written on our hearts, but we suppress that because we want to do our own thing. In fact, on a lot of college campuses, I obviously have atheists show up because we call the program. I don't have enough faith to be an atheist. And obviously, they want to show up and ask questions. And sometimes they can get a little bit hostile. So it's sometimes during the Q&A, I'll stop the atheist and I'll say, wait, before we go any further, can I just ask you one question? Yeah, sure, go ahead. And this is the question you should ask all unbelievers. You ready? Here's the question. If Christianity were true, would you become a Christian? I've had atheists in front of a full auditorium of people yell back at me, no! No, wait. I thought that you were a beacon of reason being an atheist, right? Of course, if atheism's true, if we're just molecules in motion, as they say, if all that exists are material things, and we're just molecular machines, we're nothing but moist robots, we're not reasoning anyway, we're just reacting by the atheist's own worldview. But let's leave that aside. You see, they have to steal reason from God in order to try and argue against him. But let's leave that aside. I ask you, if Christianity were true, would you become a Christian? And you say no. How's that reasonable? How's that rational? It's not. Why? The problem isn't here. The problem's here. They don't want it to be true. You see, most people are not on a truth quest. They're on a happiness quest. They want to do and believe whatever they think is going to make them happy. Forget truth. Now, you can do that temporarily. You can have temporary satisfaction by following error, but long term, there's no way to get ultimate happiness without going straight through truth. Because if you know the truth will. That's right. Now, Pascal put it this way. He said, people almost invariably base their beliefs not on the basis of proof, but on the basis of what they find attractive. People believe what they find attractive. And atheists have admitted to me, well, the reason I'm not a Christian is because I don't like the moral constraints of God. You see, the elephant in the room is not evidence. The elephant in the room is morality and accountability. They don't want it. They want to be God. They don't want there to be a God. I've had the opportunity to debate Christopher Hitchens a couple of times, a great atheist. I love the guy. He had a great wit about him, had a British accent, so he sounded even more witty. And he's since passed on, as you may know. The debates are on our website. You can watch them for free. But when you watch Hitchens and when you read his book, you realize he was just mad at God. I mean, he called God a cosmic North Korean dictator, peering down on our sex lives, trying to tell us what to do. It's always something about sex. You notice what the new religion is in America? The new religion is sex. It's an old religion, just resurrected, but now it's in America. That's the new religion, sex. And so he was upset with God. Which is why, at the end of both debates, I said, you could sum up Christopher Hitchens' book in one sentence. Here it is. There is no God, and I hate him. He was mad at God. And there may be friends in your life that are mad at God. Maybe you're here, you're not a Christian, you might be mad at God. That's okay, God can take it. You know, many of the biblical writers are mad at God. You notice that? God, where are you? Why are you letting this happen? It's fine. But if you're mad at God, you're assuming there's a moral standard out there, and there can only be a moral standard if God exists. If you're upset with injustice, then justice must exist. And justice can only exist if God exists, but we'll get to that later. All right, let's now move on to question two. Does God exist? The first question, does truth exist? Obviously, it's true, because to say it isn't true, you're uttering a truth claim. So if our reasoning is good to this point, we've just pointed out that both postmodernism and relativism aren't true. Why? Because postmodernism and relativism say there is no truth, while claiming it's true, there is no truth. You got it? All right, good. Let's now move on to the next question. Is it true that God exists? Now, whenever we talk about God, we've got to define our terms. When I'm talking about God, I'm talking about a theistic God. You need my good side? Here it is. All right, good. You with me? Okay, good. You got to define what we mean by God. And when I'm talking about God, I'm talking about a theistic God, a being who's beyond the world, who created the world and sustains the world, a being whose attributes are expressed in the universe, but he's not the universe, a being whose attributes are expressed in you, but he's not you. That's a theistic God. A theistic God is to the universe and to you what a band is to music. If a band were up here playing music, the band would be creating and sustaining the music. As soon as the band stopped playing, what would happen to the music? Music's over. So the God I'm talking about doesn't just create the universe and then leave it. The God that I'm talking about creates the universe and sustains the universe. He's sustaining us right now. We'll talk about this in the third service on Sunday. The sustaining God, not just the creating God. Now, you know, of course, of the worldview that thinks God is the universe. You know what that is? Use the force, Luke. The whole Star Wars series is about pantheism, not theism. We're talking about theism here. And there's three great arguments for a theistic God. Two of them have scientific evidence behind them. One has more philosophical evidence. The first is the argument from the beginning of the universe known as the cosmological argument. And cosmological comes from the Greek word cosmos, which means world or universe. It says if the universe had a beginning, it must have had a beginner. The second argument is the argument from design known as the teleological argument. Telos, meaning design or purpose, says if there's design in the universe and design in life, there must be a designer. Now, you can get evidence for these arguments by looking either through a telescope or looking through a microscope, which we'll do. But the third argument is not a scientific argument. As I mentioned, it's more philosophical in nature. Yet it's the argument we've all known since we were very small children. And it's the argument from morality known as the moral argument. And it says if there's one thing morally wrong out there, like it's wrong to torture babies for fun, or it's wrong to murder 6 million people in a Holocaust, then there has to be a God. Why? Because if there is no standard beyond humanity, then that's just your opinion against a baby torturer's opinion, or your opinion against, say, Hitler's opinion. We all intuitively understand those things are really objectively wrong, so there must be a source outside of humanity which establishes it as being objectively wrong, and that's what we mean by God's nature. But let's start right here at point one, the first argument, the cosmological argument, and this is the argument that many say points back to the big... Now, some of you are going, you know, Frank, we're Christians in here, we don't believe in a Big Bang. You guys don't believe in the Big Bang? I believe in the Big Bang. I just know who banged it. In fact, the evidence for the Big Bang is quite good. You even have atheistic scientists admitting that space, matter, and time had a beginning. Stephen Hawking, one of the most famous atheists in the world, says, almost everyone now believes that the universe and time itself had a beginning at the Big Bang. A colleague of his, Alexander Vilenkin, who teaches at Tufts University, he's a Russian cosmologist, went to Hawking's 70th birthday party a few years ago and presented a paper where he said, all the evidence we have at this point shows that the universe, time, space, and matter had a beginning. A few years prior to that, he wrote a book called Many Worlds in One. Here's what he concluded. With the proof now in place, cosmologists can no longer hide behind the possibility of a past eternal universe. There is now no escape. They have to face the problem of a cosmic beginning. Now, Vilenkin was a believer in the multiverse. Have you heard of this? This is the idea that there are many universes out there, and we just happen to be in the one that looks designed. But even Vilenkin admits this. He says, first of all, there's no evidence for this, but they're just coming up with it to avoid God. But let's suppose there are other universes out there. Vilenkin says, even if that's the case, the whole show, all the universes together needed an absolute beginning. So you don't get rid of the need for a beginner. Now, what's the evidence for this? I'm not going to go into it. Because it's really not even controversial. You can get the book, chapter 3. We go through all the evidence for this. I want to jump to the conclusion because we have limited time here tonight. The atheists are not denying the fact that space, matter, and time had a beginning. So what do we do with that? Well, if the universe had a beginning, then it must have had a beginner. The evidence leaves us with one of the following two options. Either no one created something out of nothing, which is the atheistic view, or someone created something out of nothing, which is the theistic view. Now, my only question is this: which view is more reasonable? That no one created something out of nothing, or that someone created something out of nothing? What do you think? Someone, right? I was at Texas A&M a few years ago, giving this presentation, and an atheist said, "Oh, I think number one is more reasonable." I said, wait. Number one is more reasonable? First of all, let's look at number two first. Number two says someone created something out of nothing. Now, that is a miracle. But at least you got a miracle worker, right? You got someone right there. Number one is a miracle with no miracle worker. That's absurd. I said, to show you how seriously we all take the law of causality. And oh, by the way, the law of causality does not say everything has a cause. The law of causality says everything that comes to be has a cause. There has to be an uncaused first cause. There has to be what Aristotle called an unmoved mover. There has to be a being that's always existed that got everything else started and keeps it moving. That's what we mean by God. We're talking about everything that comes to be. And the universe came to be. So someone must have created it. In fact, I said to the audience that night, to show you how seriously we all take the law of causality, that things don't pop into existence out of nothing by nothing without a cause. There is nobody sitting in this auditorium here tonight who is currently worried that as you sit here, a hippopotamus has appeared out of nothing by nothing in your dorm room and is currently defecating on your pillow. Right? You don't worry about that. You're not worried right here as we sit here right now that a raging Bengal tiger is just going to appear right here and charge into the audience. You don't worry about that kind of thing, right? Why? Because things don't happen that way. And if things do pop into existence out of nothing by nothing without a cause, why doesn't everything do so? Why don't Teslas, coolest car ever made, or MacBook Pros pop into existence out of nothing by nothing without a cause? Could have saved me $3,000. If you go home tonight and you're hungry for a pizza, should you order one or should you just sit there, hope, and wait? Things don't pop into existence out of nothing by nothing without a cause. And the universe came into existence out of nothing. No, it didn't come from a quantum vacuum. No, it didn't come from swirling mathematical points. These are things atheists have come up with. It came from nothing. No space, no matter, no time. What is nothing? Aristotle had a good definition of nothing. He said, nothing is what rocks dream about. It's also what men think about when their wives say, "What are you thinking about?" "Nothing. I actually was just looking for the remote. I think I need to watch SportsCenter for the 8th time today." All right, there's a lot more in the book, but we got to move on to the next argument, and that's the design argument, the teleological argument. And the first aspect of this argument shows that the universe is highly fine-tuned, that if you were to change any one of a number of factors about the universe, we wouldn't be here. The universe didn't just explode into being out of nothing like a random explosion. It exploded into being with extreme precision, that if you were to change any one of a number of factors about the universe, be them constants in the constants of nature or the forces of nature, if you were to change any of these things slightly, any one of them, we wouldn't exist. In fact, Stephen Hawking, again an atheist, put it this way. He said, if the expansion rate of the universe was different by one part in 1,000,000,000,000 a second after the Big Bang, the universe would have collapsed back on itself or never developed galaxies. If you change the expansion rate, that infinitesimal amount from the very beginning, we're not here. Now, what does this say about Darwinism? Nothing. But I always hear atheists saying, well, look, if macroevolution's true, you don't need God. That's nonsense. You need a creator and a designer from the very beginning. Before you can ever get to biology, you need a universe. And the universe itself was fine-tuned from the split second it began, and it remains fine-tuned today. Do you know that the expansion rate of the universe is accelerating right now? We don't know why. Dark matter, dark energy, we're not sure, but it's actually accelerating, and that expansion rate is fine-tuned. I mean, you would think if the universe was really expanding, there'd be far less traffic on the California highways. But it took me 2 hours to go 38 miles last night. You people are crazy. Glendale to Chino Hills. 38 miles, 2 hours. If I had traveled at the speed of light, I could have been here yesterday. Also, the gravitational force, if it were altered by more than 1 part in 10 to the 40, the sun wouldn't exist, so neither would we. Now, what's 1 part in 10 to the 40? It's really hard to get your mind around a number like this, so let me give you an illustration. First of all, it's 1 part in 1 with 40 zeros following it. Okay, so this is a very precise number. Now, here's an illustration. Take a tape measure and stretch it across the entire known universe. Now, that's a long way. Set the gravitational force at a particular inch mark on that tape measure. I realize gravity's not measured in inches, but this is just to give you a scale idea in your mind. If you were to move the strength of gravity 1 inch in either direction across the scale of the entire known universe, we wouldn't be here. That's 1 in 10 to the 40 precision. There's only 3 possible explanations for that gravitational force value to be what it is. Physical necessity, it had to be there. No, it didn't have to be there. It could have been here, could have been here, could have been a trillion miles that way or that way. Chance. I don't have enough faith to believe that just happened by chance. In fact, what does the word chance mean? Is chance a cause? Is there a causal force out there known as chance? You know, when scientists say, well, it was caused, or we don't know, but the chance is, like, is there a cause out there? You know, who caused this? Chance! There he is! There's a ghost! No, there's not a force out there known as chance. What does the word chance mean? It's a word we use to describe mathematical possibilities when we don't know what the cause is. Chance basically means we don't know. The third possibility after physical necessity and chance is design. Somebody designed it to be right there, right where it is. That seems like the best explanation to me. The same being that created the universe put it right where it is. Arno Penzias, who was not a Christian but helped discover evidence for the Big Bang, put it this way. He said, astronomy leads us to a unique event, a universe which was created out of nothing, one with the very delicate balance needed to provide exactly the right conditions required to permit life, and one which has an underlying, one might say, supernatural plan. In fact, not only can you make this argument at the foundational level, that there are these foundational constants, but you can make it right here at the solar system level, that the solar system is designed very precisely. Where are we in the solar system? There we are, right there, third rock from the sun. If we were just a little bit closer to or a little bit further away, we wouldn't be here. A little bit closer to, we'd burn up. A little bit further away, we'd freeze. We are what scientists call the Goldilocks zone. It is not too hot. It is not too cold. It is the axial tilt, 23.5 degrees. Change that slightly, we don't exist. Earth rotation, 24 hours. Change that slightly, we don't exist. Oxygen, 21% in the atmosphere. If it were 25%, spontaneous fires would break out. If it were 15%, we'd all suffocate. If Jupiter was not in its current orbit, we wouldn't be here. Why? What does Jupiter do for us? Yes, Jupiter's gravitational force is so strong that it attracts most of the meteors and space junk to it rather than us. In fact, if you take a close-up look at Jupiter, you see what these purple marks there, right there on Jupiter are? Those are comet fragment strikes that are bigger than the Earth. Thank God for Jupiter. That's right. Because if Jupiter wasn't there, we wouldn't be here. Saturn does the same thing. In fact, I was on the Drudge Report a couple of years ago. And by the way, whenever I want to be convinced that the universe is ending today, I go to the Drudge Report. And right there on the Drudge Report, it said, scientists believe major meteor to hit Earth in 2040. I am rooting for Jupiter. Help us out, Jupiter! In fact, you want to see the size of Jupiter? Check this out. Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, Earth. Look at poor Pluto down here! You know, Pluto recently has been demoted as a planet. I don't know about you, but I think it's size discrimination. Did you see Pluto this week? Said, you think I'm not a planet? Check out these 11,000-foot mountains. Do I qualify now? Because it's got 11,000-foot mountains on it. Did you see that? Pretty amazing. Now check this out. You can hardly see Pluto. Now check this out. That's Arcturus. That's another star in our galaxy right there. The sun is over here. Jupiter is one pixel in size on this scale. Earth is invisible. Pluto, forget about it. Okay, keep an eye on Arcturus. You got Arcturus now? Check this out. Where's Arcturus now? It's right there to the left of the white star Regal. See that? That's Antares, another star in our galaxy. The sun is one pixel in size on this scale. Jupiter is invisible. Earth, Pluto, forget about them. In fact, if the Earth was the size of a golf ball, Betelgeuse here would be 5 or 6 Empire State Buildings high. This is just in our galaxy. This is not outside our galaxy. This is just in our galaxy. The heavens are awesome. In fact, the average distance between stars in our galaxy is 30 trillion miles, and all that distance is necessary for us to exist in a stable orbit here. 30 trillion miles. How far is 30 trillion miles? Far. Take you at least 2 tanks of gas on a Toyota Prius to go 30 trillion miles. That is, if the gas pedal doesn't stick. We were out in the Desert Museum a number of years ago now in Tucson, Arizona. You ever been out to Tucson? And out in Tucson, just outside of the city, a little ways outside of the city, actually, so you get away from the city lights, there is a desert museum. If you go out there at night, on a clear night, you can see thousands of stars in the sky. And the guide who took us out there said, hey, if we look up at 9:03, we're going to see the space shuttle in orbit. I said, oh, come on. We're not going to see the space shuttle in orbit. It's only 120 feet long. It's 350 miles up. We're not going to see it. At 9:03, the guide goes, look! And we look up in the sky about 70 degrees above the horizon. There's an object streaking out of the western sky relative to us about like this. I mean, it is really cooking. When it got right about here, it disappeared. I don't know whether Scotty beamed it up or what. But it was there and suddenly it was gone. Actually, what happened was, despite the fact that we were in total darkness, the space shuttle was so high up that the sun was still reflecting off of it. And when it got out of the range of the sun, we couldn't see it anymore. Now, when the space shuttle was in orbit, the space shuttle was traveling at about 18,000 miles an hour. That's 5 miles per second. You got trouble getting to work in the morning? Take the space shuttle. You'll be there. By the way, the New Horizons probe traveling out toward Pluto, 30,000 miles an hour. Now, I did a little calculation to try and figure out how long would it take us if we could get it in the space shuttle and go from our star, the sun, to another star in our galaxy an average distance away, 30 trillion miles. In other words, how long would it take us to go 30 trillion miles if we could go 5 miles a second? How long do you think it would take us? Long time. Well, you guys are really a precise crowd. It would take us 201,450 years. That means if you got in the space shuttle at the time of Christ and started traveling to another star in our galaxy an average distance away, you'd be less than 1/100th of the way there right now. And we're going to explore space. No, we're not. We're not going anywhere in space. Who'd like to go the next nearest star? We'll get it. We'll go. Get in, kids. Are we almost there yet, Dad? Another 200,000 years. Play some more Xbox. It's just too far and it's too dangerous. Just how many stars are out there? The number of stars that are out there are about equivalent to the number of grains of sand on all the beaches on all the Earth. And to go from one star to another star, going 5 miles a second, will take you over 200,000 years. You see this? See here on the left? That's from the ground. You see this little square in the middle here? That's this square on the right from the Hubble Space Telescope. Those are stars, heavenly bodies. February 1st, 2003, President Bush goes into the East Room of the White House. It's Saturday, early afternoon. They turn the TV camera on. Every major network carries his address. Saturday, midday, why? President looks in the camera and says, "My fellow Americans, this morning our country experienced a great tragedy. Upon re-entry into the atmosphere, the space shuttle Columbia burned up in the skies over Texas. There are no survivors. The Columbia is lost." The president went on then to quote from Isaiah chapter 40. Why Isaiah chapter 40? Because in Isaiah chapter 40, according to Isaiah, God is speaking. And what does God say? "To whom will you compare me, or who is my equal?" says the Holy One. In other words, you want a comparison to who God is like? Here it is. "Lift your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these stars and named them one by one? Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing." The president then looked back in the camera and said, "The same God that created and named all those stars is the same God that created and knows the names of the 7 astronauts who perished today. While they did not return safely home to us, we can all now pray they've all returned safely home." You want to know who God is? Most Christians have the wrong idea of who God is. We think God is a big angel. God is not a big angel. You want to know who God is? Meditate on the attributes of God. He's spaceless, timeless, immaterial, all-powerful. He's a creator, a sustainer. He's morally perfect. Meditate on those attributes and then remove all limits from your mind. That's God. Why is there a second commandment? Thou shalt make no graven image. At least one reason why is there a second commandment. Because any image you make of an infinite being necessarily limits his majesty. You can't draw a picture of an infinite being. You could draw a picture of Jesus because he had a human nature in addition to a divine nature, but you can't draw a picture of God, a divine God, an unlimited being. The closest thing in our experience to infinity are the heavens. That's why the Bible says the heavens declare the glory of God. That's why Psalm 103 verse 11 says, "God's love to those that fear him exceeds the height of the heavens above the earth." How high are the heavens above the earth? Number of stars equivalent to grains of sand on all the beaches on all the earth. 200,000 years at 5 miles a second between those stars. Infinite from our perspective. That's the point. Now, not only can you look into a telescope and see evidence of design, you can also look into a microscope and see it. Do you see this? This is a one-celled amoeba that the Darwinists say we all evolved from. You heard of the theory of macroevolution? From the goo to you via the zoo? Okay. This is the goo. Now, in Darwin's day, this was not considered to be any big deal, that maybe natural forces could work on non-living chemicals, where they got the chemicals from, who knows, and create a one-celled amoeba, and from there, natural selection could take over, and ultimately, we could get all these diverse life forms that we see here today. But we didn't know, Darwin didn't know, what a cell really was. It's only recently we were able to break the black box of a cell. And now when we open up a cell, what we see is a city, virtually, like a huge factory. And in fact, inside this factory, inside this city, is a world of astonishing machinery and complexity. And part of that machinery and complexity is a language called a genome. In fact, in order to show you this, I got to take you to your breakfast table. How many people in here like alphabet cereal? Anyone like alphabet cereal? Let's suppose you want a bowl of alphabet cereal one morning. You come downstairs. You're a teenager. You want to have a bowl of alphabet cereal, and you see the box is knocked over on the table, and right in the middle, the letter spell, "Take out the garbage, Mom." What are you going to assume? The cat knocked the box over? Earthquake shook the house? No, you're going to say that that's intelligent design from an intelligent being, Mom. Or let's say you're walking along the beach and you see in the sand, John loves Mary. What do you assume? The waves did that? Crabs came out of the water and made that message? No, you're going to say that that message had to come from a mind, because you know in all your prior experience that messages only come from minds. Well, if messages only come from minds, where does this message come from? DNA, which is equivalent to a message like take out the garbage, Mom. It's just a lot longer. In fact, the longest word we've ever discovered is in every one of your 40 trillion cells. It's 3.5 billion letters long. All the letters are in the right order. Who put them in that order? In fact, even Bill Gates, who, as you know, is not a Christian, put it this way. He said, human DNA is like a software program, but it's much more complex than anything we've ever developed. I don't know about you, but where I see a program, I think there must be a programmer. When I see a code, there must be a coder. If I see a message, there must be a messenger. Every living thing has DNA. Now, you might say, well, wait a minute. Maybe the amoeba's DNA started out really primitive, and then it evolved. Well, first of all, you really can't evolve a code, right? Like, if I were to take the code that's running Microsoft PowerPoint right now on this computer and begin to mutate it randomly, how long do you think I'd be able to show you this presentation? No. But let's humor the assertion here that maybe the code started very, very primitively. How much information is in a one-celled amoeba? And by the way, an amoeba is so small, you can line up several hundred in an inch. And how much information in DNA is in an amoeba? The amount of information in an amoeba is about equivalent to 1,000 volumes of an encyclopedia. Now, to believe that that resulted by natural forces is like believing that the Library of Congress resulted from an explosion in a printing shop. I don't have enough faith to believe that. The first life seems to require an intelligent cause. Now, who told me this? Some Christian? You know who told me this? Probably the most famous atheist in the world today, along with Stephen Hawking, is Richard Dawkins. Richard Dawkins. He says this in his book, The Blind Watchmaker. He says there's that much information in an amoeba. How did this get there? It seems to be the product of intelligence. Now, by the way, this is not a God of the gaps argument. How many know what I'm talking about when I say God of the gaps argument? You know, you're plugging God into the gap of your knowledge, and then you later learn it was really a natural cause that did it, and you look stupid for saying God did it. This is not one of those arguments. Why? Because we're not arguing from what we don't know. We're arguing from what we do know. When you see take out the garbage, Mom, on your table, you don't just lack a natural explanation. When you see take out the garbage, Mom, on your table, you go, that's positive evidence for an intelligent being. Again, you're not arguing from what you don't know. You're arguing from what you do know. In fact, let's take one more look at biology. This is you in the womb at 11 weeks. We were all there at one point. Now, question, is this animal, mineral, vegetable, or human? Human. In fact, let's go back even earlier. Let's go back to when your mother and your father got together. Have you guys had this talk before? I see some young people, so I'll try and be discreet. When your mother and your father got together, your mother unconsciously perfumed her egg, and then your father sent the entire population of the United States, 300 million soldiers, toward your mother's egg. And then there was a race, and you won. Don't let anyone ever tell you you're not special. You beat out 300 million others. You have blown away anything Michael Phelps has done. Now, seeing some of you limp in here earlier makes it hard for me to believe you were the fastest soldier in the gene pool. But you were. Now, your soldier was 20 to 30 times smaller than a grain of salt, yet it contained half of the genetic information that makes you you. And your mother's egg was about the size of a period at the end of a sentence in an average book, and it contained the other half of the genetic information that makes you you. And when your soldier and your egg came together, a new 100% genetic human being was created. You know, you have not received any more genetic information from that point till right now. Your genetic information has just duplicated itself. In fact, there were only four things separating you from adulthood. Time, air, water, and food. Those are the same four things that separate a two-year-old from adulthood. Does this have implications on the abortion issue? Of course it does. We don't kill the two-year-old. Why do we kill the unborn child in the womb? Genetically, it's the same. You say, Frank, we can't legislate morality. We're going to talk about that tomorrow. It turns out that's the only thing you can legislate. Right? But let's get back to this. From that point to right now, there was an astonishing construction project that began. Cells began multiplying at a rate of 4,000 cells per second. Brain cells began multiplying at a rate of 100,000 cells per second. For most of you, anyway. Some cells became brain cells. Other cells became heart cells. Other cells became lung cells. How did they know how to do this? Nobody knows. Some cells went so far across you to become what they needed to become that it would be equivalent to you today walking across the United States alone. And that construction project continues to this day. You just made 4 million new red blood cells. You just made another 4 million new red blood cells. You just made another 4 million new red... Knock it off! How do you know how to do this? Are you thinking there going, got to make more red blood cells? Hang on. You know, how is this happening? You know how this is happening? We're going to talk about this a little bit in the third service on Sunday. It's happening because nature is goal-directed. And it's goal-directed because there's an external intellect directing it toward an end. And that's what we mean by God. He doesn't just create the universe. He sustains it. All of nature is going toward a direction, including the laws of nature themselves. Atheists are always talking about, well, you got the laws of nature. Where do the laws of nature come from? They're laws. Laws come from lawgivers. So there really is a being out there that created and sustains all this. Now, this doesn't necessarily prove Christianity at this point. You got to get all the way to the New Testament to see if it's the Christian God. But we're building a case right now for a being like the God of the Bible. In fact, let's do one more argument, and that is the argument from morality, known as the moral argument. A number of years ago, I had the opportunity to go across Europe, and we stopped on our way at the Buchenwald concentration camp in Weimar, Germany. And when the Allies liberated the camp in April of 1945, they went through the front gate, and it's still there. And then they looked over to the right, and they saw the crematorium about 100 yards off in the distance. It's still there. And then when we got to the crematorium, they looked into the courtyard attached to the crematorium, and this is what they saw. Brace yourself. Now, if there is no God, this is just a matter of opinion. You see, if there is no standard beyond humanity, that's just your opinion against, say, Hitler's opinion. You may say it's wrong, but Hitler may say it's right. Who's to say anybody's right or wrong if there's no standard beyond you and Hitler? In fact, let me ask you the question this way. How do you know, or how can you discover who's right and wrong? Mother Teresa or Hitler? Mother Teresa, the Catholic nun who devoted herself to serving the poor in Calcutta, or Hitler, the mass murderer of World War II? Well, let me ask you the question this way. How do you know which map of Scotland is better? What would you need to see in order to know which map was better? Yeah, you would need to see a real unchanging place called Scotland. If Scotland didn't exist, then these two maps would be meaningless, right? But since Scotland does exist, we can see map A, while it's not perfect, is a better representation of the real Scotland than is map B. Why? Because we have an external referent, a real Scotland, by which we can measure the other maps. And that's exactly what we do when we compare Mother Teresa and Hitler. Mother Teresa wasn't the standard. Hitler wasn't the standard. There's a standard beyond both of them by which we measure both of them. And we say God's nature is the standard. Mother Teresa lived up to the standard better than did Hitler. That standard is God's very nature. There's not a standard beyond him he has to look at. He doesn't invent the standard. He is the standard. He is the standard of all goodness. Now, if there is no God, then the Nazis were not really wrong. I was at Michigan State doing this presentation, And on this side of the auditorium during the Q&A, there were a couple atheists, and we got talking, and I said to one of them, I said, well, you're an atheist. What's your standard for morality? And one of them said, whatever the majority decides is morally right. And I said, are you telling me that if you lived in Nazi Germany and decided it was morally right to murder any undesirable, like Jews, homosexuals, gypsies, Jehovah's Witnesses, that that would be morally right? And he paused, and he blushed, and he said, yes. And his atheist buddy sitting right next to him looked at him and yelled, no! The first kid knew in his heart the answer was no. But in order to be consistent with his atheism, he had to say yes. But of course, even if atheism's true, there is no moral standard. Whoever has the most power gets to impose it on people, but it's not morally right or wrong. There's no standard. That's the ultimate problem with atheism when it comes to morality. There is no standard. Anything goes. Everything's a matter of opinion, and we all know in our hearts there are some things that really are morally wrong. If there's one thing morally wrong, you don't have to have all morality squared away, just one thing, like it's wrong to torture babies for fun, God exists. In fact, if there is no God, love is no better than rape. Not in an objective sense. We may not obviously like love better than rape, but it's not objectively right or wrong. There are no human rights. Where do rights come from? They don't come from government. They come from God. Governments are instituted among men to secure rights, as the Declaration of Independence says. Not to give them, not to take them away. So the Supreme Court isn't the standard of rights. And if it was, it wouldn't be a right, it would be an opinion. That's why the opinion is aptly named. It's just that, an opinion, right? Rights can only come from God. Here's the problem. I see atheists all the time saying they have certain rights. How can you have a right if there's no God? It's just your opinion. It's just your opinion. If there's no standard beyond humanity, there are no rights. I don't care what side of the political aisle you're on. I don't care if you're for same-sex marriage or against it. I don't care if you're for abortion or against it. I don't care. There's no rights either way. There's no right to same-sex marriage or natural marriage. There's no right to abortion or life. There's no right to anything if there's no God. It's just a bunch of human beings who aren't anything special. We're not endowed by our Creator if there's no God. We're just overgrown germs. Tolerance is no better than intolerance. Political liberals talk about tolerance all the time. You know, I've noticed that the people who say they're fighting for tolerance are often the most intolerant. You ever notice that? I often ask Christians, are Christians commanded to be tolerant? No, why? Tolerance is too weak. Tolerance says, hold your nose and put up with them. Love says, reach out and help them. And sometimes in order to love, you can't tolerate something. Why? Because it's hurting them and others. In fact, you know this as parents, right? If you let your kid do everything the kid wants, if you tolerate everything the kid wants to do, are you a loving parent? No. Same thing is true when it comes to our laws. If we tolerate everything, we're not loving. We have to stand against evil. And unfortunately, in our country, we're not just allowing evil, we're now celebrating it. Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, says God in Isaiah chapter 5, verse 20. So no, we're not commanded to be tolerant, we're commanded to be loving. And there's such a thing out there as false compassion. That's like, oh, I'm with you, whatever you want to do, just don't be mad at me. And then there's true compassion. I love you so much, I'm going to tell you don't do this, even if you hate me for it. Religious crusades are not wrong. I always hear atheists, particularly Christopher Hitchens, kept talking about, well, there's so much evil done by religious people, to which I said, you know, you're right, Christopher. Religious people have done a lot of evil. But you're an atheist. Where do you get evil from if there's no God? How do you even know what evil is if there's no standard of good? In fact, if there is no God, you can't complain about the problem of evil. Why? Well, C.S. Lewis said it very well. He said it best. He was an atheist for a long while until, well, he said there couldn't be a God because there's too much injustice in the world. Then one day he had an epiphany. He ultimately wrote it in the book Mere Christianity after he became a Christian. He put it this way. He said, as an atheist, my argument against God was that the universe seems so cruel and unjust, but how would I got this idea of just and unjust? A man does not call a line crooked unless he has some idea of a straight line. What was I comparing this universe with when I called it unjust? You see, something can't be unjust unless something is just. Something can't be not right unless something is right. So you got to keep asking people, what's your standard? Is your standard just you, or is there a standard beyond you? And if it's beyond you, what is that standard? Keep asking the question, what is your standard? Oh, it's the Constitution. Really? Is the Constitution the ultimate standard? It might be for many politically, but you know, the Supreme Court at one point said blacks were not people. They also said babies were not human beings. Now the Supreme Court has said that marriage isn't what it's always been, and it's been made between a man and a woman, not because of bigotry, but because of biology. It's been that way forever. In fact, marriage is the first institution. The government came after marriage, then came the church. Governments recognize marriage. They don't define marriage. We just recognize what's already there. In fact, the shadows prove the sunshine. In order to have sunshine, you got to have shadows. Or I should say, in order to have shadows, you have to have sunshine. Oh, you can have sunshine without shadows. You can have good without evil, but you can't have evil without good. You can't have shadows without sunshine. So when atheists say, well, there can't be a good God because there's too much evil in the world, what are they presupposing? They're presupposing there's a standard of good, but in order for there to be a standard of good, God must exist. So evil doesn't disprove God. Evil may prove there's a devil out there, but evil doesn't disprove God because, again, evil wouldn't exist unless good existed, and good wouldn't exist unless God existed. So evil is actually a backhanded argument for God. I know this is going to sound strange, but if evil exists, God exists. Not because God is doing evil, but because God is the standard of good by which evil is even possible. This is all unpacked in the Stealing from God book in the chapter on evil, if you want to go further. All right, so what can we conclude from these arguments? The cosmological, teleological, and moral arguments. Remember how I said in the beginning, we're going to try and show there's really a spaceless, timeless, immaterial, powerful, moral, personal, intelligent creator out there from these three arguments? Let's draw some conclusions now. From the cosmological argument, we can see that this being is immaterial, timeless, and spaceless. Why? Because the being created material time and space. So if the being created material time and space, the being can't be made of material time and space, right? In other words, it must be immaterial, timeless, and spaceless. Oh, by the way, this answers the who made God objection. You always hear, well, who made God? If you're timeless, do you have a beginning? No, nobody made God. God is the unmoved mover. He's the uncreated creator. Also, we know from the cosmological argument, this being is extremely powerful because he created out of nothing. We create out of pre-existing material. God creates out of nothing. No space, no matter, no time. Also, from the design argument, we can see this being is extremely intelligent because this universe is put together with extreme precision. We can see that he sustains creation and he has purpose. We're here for a reason. From the moral argument, we can see that this being is absolutely morally perfect, and we can also see that this being is personal. How do we know this being is personal from the moral argument? Because you only have a moral obligation to persons. You don't have a moral obligation to impersonal forces. If you go try and dunk a basketball, you're not sinning against the law of gravity. You only sin against persons. We also know this being is personal from the cosmological argument. You say, how so? Because in order to go from a state of nothingness, there was no space, no matter, no time, just God, someone had to make a choice. And only persons make choices. Gravity can't choose to create something, right? I mean, gravity doesn't choose stuff. Gravity doesn't go, look, if Turek drops that remote one more time, I'm not going to pull it to the ground, right? It just does the same thing over and over again. But a person has to be someone to choose to go from a state of nothingness to a state of creation. So notice this. We have an immaterial, timeless, spaceless, extremely powerful, extremely intelligent, sustaining creator who has purpose, who's absolutely morally perfect and personal. This is the God of biblical Christianity identified without reference to the Bible. We haven't even opened the Bible yet, and we have a being that suspiciously looks like the God of the Bible. Now, does this necessarily mean that Christianity is true? No, why? Because we don't know anything about Jesus yet. All we know is it seems like we have a theistic God. Maybe one of these other theisms is true. Maybe it's Judaism or Islam. Actually, it can't be Islam. Why? Because according to Muslim doctrine, Allah is arbitrary. He's not the standard of goodness. Whatever he does is good. But I put it up here because it is a theistic worldview, a major theistic worldview. Now, if this God really exists and wants to show us which one of these religious worldviews is true, What could he do? He could do something only he could do, and that would be a miracle. Now, I'm not going to do a miracle here. I think Pastor Jack is going to come out a little bit later and do one. He told me earlier today he would, so you guys may want to hang out after I go back, okay? But I'm just going to talk about him for a few minutes, and then we're going to go to questions. Okay, you guys ready? Let's talk a little bit about miracles. We only have a few minutes here because I want to get to questions, but let's talk about miracles. And let me ask this question. When miracles occur in the Bible, when God does miracles through people in the Bible, when does he do them? What is the purpose of a miracle in the Bible?
To glorify God.
And how is it done when God is doing a miracle through a person? Well, first of all, let me ask a question even before this. How many miracles are there in the Bible? Anyone know?
A lot.
Another good answer. This is the precision crowd over here. This is the hand grenade and horseshoe crowd over here. Just get it close. A lot. There's about 250 miracles in the Bible, approximately, depending upon how you count them. Some are bunched up. But let's just say there's 250 miracles from, say, Abraham all the way to Jesus. Now, that's about 2,000 years. So, if you got 250 miracles divided over 2,000 years, how often, on average, do you get a miracle? Once every 8 years, right? That's 250 into 2,000 for you math majors. You just said not very much, right? When I get, yeah, okay. But do they happen that way? Do you get a miracle, and then 8 years later, you get another miracle, and then 8 years later, you get another miracle, and then, no. You'll notice that miracles occur in bunches. Why? Well, first of all, where do they occur? They occur around Moses, Elijah and Elisha, and Jesus and the apostles. When God is doing miracles through people, sometimes he does them directly, obviously, but when he's doing them through people, this is when he's doing them. Why? Because these people have new revelation that needs new confirmation. Why, says Moses, is Pharaoh going to believe me? And God says, you'll be able to do some miracles. I'm going to do some miracles through you, and Pharaoh will ultimately get the point. That's how we know Moses spoke for God. He could do miracles. You see, the point here is the miracle confirms the message, the sign confirms the sermon. That's the main purpose of miracles in the Bible, to show you that so-and-so speaks for God. Go back to that verse I mentioned earlier. John says, these things were done so that you may know Jesus is the Messiah or the Savior, and that by believing in his name, you may have eternal life. That's the purpose. They're not happen randomly. They're not happen for entertainment purposes. There are periods in the Bible where there's hundreds of years, no miracles. And we think they're happening all the time. No, they're not. Now, a lot of people believe miracles are impossible. Like, for example, Noah. How can you believe the Noah miracle? It seems outlandish. I actually believe the Noah miracle occurred. In fact, in 2006, I went on a Noah's Ark expedition into Iran. I don't have time to tell you all the details, but my friend who's the real Indiana Jones, Bob Cornuke, and I, and a bunch of other guys went into Iran. We went into Elburz Mountains, about 55 miles northwest of Tehran, and we got up to this object at 13,000 feet, about 5,000 feet above the tree line. It's an odd-looking thing sticking out of the side of a mountain. We got up to it. It looked like it could have been planking from an old boat, but when we reached out and touched it, it was rock. So we pulled some samples off the formation there. We brought them back to the United States, and 5 out of the 9 samples tested as petrified wood. But we can't prove it's Noah's Ark because it didn't say USS Noah on the side. How would you prove that? Interesting find. A lot of people believe resurrections don't occur. Why? They've never seen one. Everyone they know who's dead is still dead, right? And by the way, miracles have to be rare if they're going to get our attention. Imagine if people were popping up from the dead all the time. What would the resurrection of Christ be for us? You know, you go to somebody and you say, Jesus rose from the dead for your sins, and you go, so what? Uncle George just rose from the dead 3 days ago. Now I got to give the inheritance back. Right? I mean, miracles have to be rare if they're going to get our attention. They can't be happening all the time, otherwise we lose the apologetic value of the miracles in the Bible. Of course it's a good point. What do you think, I'm up here giving bad points? That was the first good point I made all night. And for some reason, the problem miracle in the Bible, when we're from New Jersey, we think everything we say is a good point. You know, let me tell you something. The big miracle problem in the Bible is, of course, Jonah. Is that a whale of a tale or a tale of a whale? What is the deal with Jonah? How can you believe in Jonah? Now, question. What is the greatest miracle in the Bible? Yeah, most people say the resurrection. It's a biggie, but it's easy compared to the greatest miracle in the Bible. Yes, the greatest, that's a good point. The greatest miracle in the Bible is the first verse. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. If that verse is true, every other verse is at least possible, right? Well, here's the interesting thing. We now have scientific evidence the first verse of the Bible is true, even philosophical evidence. That the first verse of the Bible is true. That in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. If that verse is true, are these verses possible? Of course, if God can create the whole universe out of nothing, he can do whatever he wants that's not logically impossible inside the universe. If he can create the whole show out of nothing, can he raise Jesus from the dead? Easy. Can he do the Jonah miracle? Easy. The Noah miracle? Easy. Any other miracle? Easy if he can create the whole show out of nothing. When people say they don't believe in miracles, I say, look around, you're living in one. This universe is a miracle. You're a miracle. Now, I just said something that you go, that might not be. You said, God can do whatever he wants. It's not logically possible. I thought God can do everything. No, there's some things God can't do. Like, he can't do logically impossible things. Like, he can't create a square circle. Doesn't exist. Can't create a one-ended stick. Doesn't exist. Can't create a married bachelor. Doesn't exist. Can't create an honest politician. Doesn't exist. There are some things that are too hard for God. In fact, you can do some things that God can't do. Like, what can you do that God can't do? You can lie. You can sin. You can change. If God could do those things, he wouldn't be God. I mean, what's he going to change from? He's already a perfect being. Any change would necessitate a move from perfection to imperfection. He is the standard by which everything else is measured. That's not a weakness in him that he can't change. It would be a weakness if he could. We can get better or worse. God's already perfect. If he changes, he can only get worse. So he doesn't change. Now, by the way, one other thing about miracles. Well, let me mention this. Notice that Jesus, if the New Testament documents are reliable, relates two of the most controversial miracles in the Old Testament to his own life, Jonah and Noah. Do you think Jesus thought Noah and Jonah were historical or hysterical? He thought they were historical, and look, if the first verse of the Bible is true, every other verse is at least possible. You may have never seen a miracle. I personally have never seen a miracle. Well, the 2007 Giants were pretty close. It was. Caught the ball off his helmet. Anyway, I've never seen a real, true miracle. But because I've never seen one, does that mean they don't exist? No. In fact, the greatest miracle of all we have evidence for, the creation of the universe out of nothing. So Jesus thought they were really true. In fact, as C.S. Lewis said, if we admit God, must we admit miracles? Indeed, you have no security against it. That is the bargain. If God exists, miracles are possible. One more point about miracles. A lot of atheists, or some of them, will say, well, you know, natural laws are immutable. You can't change them. First of all, you don't have to change a natural law to do a so-called miracle. You can overpower natural laws. Agents can overpower them. I'm overpowering it right now. What am I overpowering? Gravity. Now, if the agent lets it go, okay, gravity takes over, right? But I can pick it up, throw it around, because an agent can overpower a natural law. If God, or if we can overpower natural laws, can God? Of course. So don't buy into this idea that miracles are not possible. Of course they're possible. The God who created the universe can overpower any of the natural laws he created at any point, anytime he wants. Now, finally, is the New Testament true? And we don't have time to get into it tonight. That's what we're going to talk about second service on Sunday, right here in this room. That is, if the Lord doesn't come before then. So if the Lord comes before then, you'll be here maybe, but hopefully I won't. Okay, so...